Stuart needs no introduction. It's lovely to have him here again. You're very welcome, Stuart, to preach and celebrate. Before we go any further, I don't know if you've heard, but some very sad news. Val Orty died on Friday. Now, as you know, Val was a regular member of this church. She helped so much with all the events and everything. And she died quite suddenly, Friday morning. She will be brought to church eventually, but there are no funeral arrangements yet. But more cheerful, more weddings. We had a very successful wedding yesterday. The sun shone, despite the restrictions. So today I'm going to publish the banns of marriage between Ross David Whitley and Sophia Jane Lister, both of this parish. If any of you know any cause or just impediment why these two persons should not be joined together in holy matrimony, ye are to declare it now. This is for the second time of asking. Let us pray for Ross and Sophie. Heavenly Father, as Ross and Sophie prepare to embark on marriage, we pray for them that their lives will be a fruitful one. We pray for the preparations for the wedding. And we pray, Lord, that they will have a happy, fruitful, and really happy marriage lasting many years. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. And can I have my own word of greeting this morning, not only to those of you here in church, but also those who are watching online. Wherever you might be, we send you greetings. I think I mentioned last time I was here that in one church I was at, somebody was in Tenerife sharing in that particular service. So whether they're joining us, of course, from St. Ives, we might be having presidents and other people joining us this morning. Who knows? But it's lovely to be here again and share this morning's service with you. And so we meet in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Before we go any further, we come to a time of confession, when we have the opportunity to bring before God all that happened last week, the things we omitted to do, and the things we shouldn't have done. As children of a loving Heavenly Father, let us ask his forgiveness, for he is gentle and full of compassion. May your love and mercy come to me, O Lord, and your salvation according to your word. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Your word is a lantern at my feet and a light to my path. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Oh, let your mercy come to me, that I may live, for your law is my delight. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And so the colleague for this Sunday, the prayer for this Sunday, the second Sunday after Trinity. Lord, you have taught us that all our doings without love are nothing worth. Send your Holy Spirit and pour into our hearts that most excellent gift of love, the true bond of peace and of all virtues, without which whoever lives is counted dead before you. Grant this for your only Son, Jesus Christ's sake, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The epistle is taken from Paul's letter to the Corinthians, chapter 5. Therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in this body, we are away from the Lord. We live by faith and not by sight. We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So we make it our goal to please him, whether we are at home in the body or away from it. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive what is due to him for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. Since then, we know what it is to fear the Lord. We try to persuade men. What we are is plain to God, and I hope it is also plain to your conscience. We are not trying to commend ourselves to you again, but giving you an opportunity to take pride in us, so that you can answer those who take pride in what is seen rather than what is in the heart. If we are out of our mind, it is for the sake of God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the gospel. Holy Gospel is written in the Gospel of St. Mark, chapter 14, beginning at the 26th verse. Glory to you, Lord. He also said, "This is what the kingdom of God is like. A man scatters seed on the ground. Night and day, whether he sleeps or gets up, the seed sprouts and grows, though he does not know how. All by itself, the soil produces corn, first the stalk and then the ear, then the full grain in the ear. As soon as the grain is ripe, he puts the sickle to it, because the harvest has come." Again he said, "What shall we say the kingdom of God is like? Or what parable shall we use to describe it? It is like a mustard seed, which is the smallest seed you plant in the ground. Yet when planted, it grows and becomes the largest of all garden plants, with such big branches that the birds of the air can perch in its shade." With many similar parables, Jesus spoke the word to them, as much as they could understand. He did not say anything to them without using a parable. But when he was alone with his own disciples, he explained everything. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Grant, Lord, in the written word and through the spoken word, we may behold the living word, our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated. I wonder if the name John Newton means anything to you. John Newton was born on the 4th of August in 1725 at Wapping in London. In his early days, his very early days, his mother Elizabeth nurtured him in the Christian faith, especially by introducing him to the Bible and to its stories. But sadly, Elizabeth died of TB when her son was aged only 7. For the next few years, young John was raised by his father, from him apparently picked up or inherited characteristics. Now, was it nature or was it nurture? But these caused him to have what one biographer describes as unsettling behaviour and impatience of restraint, which I take to mean that he was aggressive and bad-tempered. In any case, at the grand old age of 11, John Newton followed his father and went to sea, serving in the Merchant Navy. At the age of 19, he was press-ganged to serve in the Royal Navy. But again, his impatience and aggressive personality got the better of him. He rebelled against the discipline of the Navy, and he deserted. When he was caught, he was put in irons and he was flogged. But then having he managed to persuade his superiors to discharge him from the Navy, they were probably glad to see the back of him. And he signed up to serve in a slave ship. At this time in his life, he was clearly something of a wild and arrogant young man. He lived life with moral abandonment. And later he was to write again, "I sinned with a high hand and made it my study to tempt and seduce others." His first job after the Navy was in fact to be employed by a West African plantation owner who cheated him abominably. And very soon, wearing rags, he was forced to beg for his food. He did manage to move on, however, and then in 1747, at the age of 22, 23, he joined a slave ship from Liverpool, the Greyhound, it was called. And it was at this time that we might say he began to settle down and became more thoughtful and responsive. And then he experienced what he later called a great deliverance during a particularly violent storm at sea. While expecting his ship to break up and sink, he cried out, "Lord, have mercy on us." Later, he reflected on what he had said and became convinced that God had somehow spoken to him and that God's grace or special help had begun to work in him. Not that John immediately abandoned his work as a slave merchant. He continued to work as a mate and then as a captain on slave ships. But as one writer observed, hoping, as a Christian, to restrain the worst excesses of the slave trade, as he put it, prompting the life of God in the soul of both the crew, his crew, and his African cargo. It was in 1755 that he had a serious illness. But afterwards, Newton left the sea and took an office job on the shore in Liverpool. And there, increasingly, he came under the influence of men like John Wesley. John Wesley, of course, was a Church of England clergyman who went on to found Methodism. And through such influences, his disgust at the slave trade and his own part in it grew. But those first seeds of faith, first sown in John Newton all those years earlier by his mother before her premature death, that they'd been stirred into life by his traumatic experience in the storm at sea, and then nurtured by his reading of books like The Imitation of Christ, as well as the Bible, ensured that his Christian faith flourished. In fact, after 7 years of applying, and the delay presumably was because of his checkered history, in the year 1764, on the 17th of July, which the anniversary will be, I think, on next Thursday, he was ordained into the Church of England. Eventually, he went on to become vicar of a London parish, and there became a keen anti-slave campaigner. It is said that he was a major influence on William Wilberforce not to become ordained, but rather to stay in politics and work in Parliament for the abolition of slavery. And here's what it says on the plaque commemorating his life in the Church of St. Mary's Woolnoth in London, where he was vicar. And these words were written by John Newton himself. It says, "John Newton, Clerk, once an infidel and libertine, a servant of slaves in Africa, was, by the rich mercy of our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, restored, pardoned, and appointed to preach the gospel which he had long laboured to destroy. He ministered nearly 16 years in Olney in Buckinghamshire and 28 years in this church." It's a fascinating story of his life, isn't it? Very dramatic. My reason for sharing it with you is to pick up that simple image that Jesus painted for us in our Gospel reading this morning. Jesus spoke, you remember, about the tiny mustard seed and how, as small as it is, given the right circumstances and nurture, it will grow into a great bush, large enough for birds to settle in. And so it is with the kingdom or rule of God. The seeds of the kingdom were sown in John Newton way back in his young, as when he was a young lad, by his loving and devoted Christian mum. His dad did his best to destroy that seed, and it had to lie dormant for many years. But then it grew. He was kick-started by that stormy night when he cried out, "Lord, have mercy on us." The flourishing of the faith in John Newton, the flourishing, that is, of the kingdom or rule of God in his life, is nowhere more obvious than in many of the hymns that he went on to write. Hymns like "How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds in a Believer's Ear," or "Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken." But by far the most popular, most well-known, most famous of all his hymns, I'm sure, is "Amazing Grace," in which, deep from within his own experience, he speaks about God who, through his grace at work in him, had rescued and restored him. I'm sure we're familiar with the first line, "Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see." We never know, do we, what seeds we are sowing as we seek to live out the Christian faith and life. As bearers of the good news of Jesus Christ, we perhaps intentionally, or more often than not, perhaps is the case, without realizing, we sow the seeds of God's kingdom that he proclaimed, and indeed that he inaugurated by his life, death, and resurrection. And there is surely no greater stimulus to that growth in others than for them to see the kingdom blossoming in the lives of those they meet. For them to see how life transforming, enriching and enhancing is the love of God active in a person's life. For them to compare perhaps the relative poverty of a life lived only for oneself to that which is other-centered. For them to see what we might call that bigger picture of reality with God at its center. And from which, what John Newton discovered, it flows the steady flow of grace that, yes, saves us from ourselves, but more positively perhaps, opens us to new ways of seeing life and of living, of viewing the present in the context of eternity, and of drawing us ever closer to the heart of God, as revealed so wonderfully and vividly, of course, in the life of Jesus Christ. Let me end by sharing two examples, two, if you like, modern examples of two men who very much have had that seed growing in them and that has borne fruit. The first, for those, and this is very current because, of course, we're in the middle now of the Euros football, aren't we? A footballer. A one-time England footballer, indeed, Jermaine Defoe. 3 years ago, in fact, he was appointed OBE. He received in the Queen's Honours List 3 years ago. And he received the honour for services to his foundation, which helps children in St. Lucia. That is, of course, in the Caribbean. I don't think he was born there, but his parents were. But he said this on his website. He said, "My relationship with God has been there from an early age, as I attended church every Sunday without fail. I truly believe that my football skills are a gift from God." And he said, of course, I suppose back to all people who received these awards, he was truly humbled to receive the honour. But the other is a man who perhaps is a little nearer home to us. Perhaps the name rings a bell with you, Dr. John Kirby. Kirkby. And he, in fact, is the man who founded Christians Against Poverty. And he was among the church people who were, that particular year, again with 2018 we are, received the honour in the birthday list. He was appointed CBE, Commander of the British Empire, for services to poverty relief. And I'll let me end by quoting what he said at the time. "I am absolutely bowled over to be receiving such an honour, and it just shows what God can do." Dr. Kirkby said, "I'd like to dedicate this to all our incredible supporters and volunteers, staff, and to our clients. I hope that it also shows what God can do with an ordinary bloke from Bradford who meets an extraordinary God and says yes."
Thank you to Stuart for such an illuminating and interesting talk. It was good to hear about John Newman. We all knew about him, but those details were really good. Shall we stand and reaffirm our faith? We say together, we believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is. We believe in God's Son, who lives in our hearts through faith, and fills us with his love. We believe in God, the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We sit for our prayers, which Daniel will lead.
Of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to them. We approach your throne of grace with our concerns, our burdens, and our thanks, giving for all people throughout the world. Help us to put our trust in you and in our Saviour Jesus Christ, who taught us that you love us as a parent and want only what is right for us. May we be like that tiny mustard seed who can flourish within our communities of Ossett and Gawthorpe as we prepare for our new clergy to arrive, Steve in July and then Andrew to join us in September. May we be thankful for these blessings that you have bestowed on us. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the Christian church throughout the world, and especially for churches in places where religious faith is suppressed or where Christianity is an unwelcome minority. We pray for our communities of Ossett and Gawthorpe this morning, that we think about those opportunities you give us day by day to share your love. Father, help us to take both of those with both our hands and grab every opportunity you give to us. Lord, in your mercy. Creator God, we pray for our world, which seems to be forever caught up in violence and conflict. Through the media, we are witnesses to terrorist violence in so many parts of the world. As we continue to pray for peace and goodwill towards all people, may we also pray for the innocent victims and their families caught up in conflicts which are not of their making. We pray for the meetings of the G7 summit, which are happening over this weekend, and that we can come out of this with positive changes for our communities and our world. And let's think about all those opportunities that you give our leaders to do what's right. We want to pray always for those to be aware of the part that we can play by always acting carefully and unselfishly. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, we pray for our children and young people as they near the end of another academic year. Be with those who are beginning important examinations at school and university, in those who start in new lives in the world of work. Help us through our Christian life to create a society where both young and old, gifted and less able, feel valued and are proud to be part of society. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Loving God, we think now of those in need in our own community and further afield, the elderly, the housebound, and those in care homes, hospital, and hospice. We also remember the victims of violence, abuse, and cruelty. We give thanks for all those who care for the sick within the family and for all our medical and voluntary services. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We pray for those who face the pain of grief at the loss of a loved one. Help us to support all those who mourn, both with our prayers and with practical help, both this day and in the days and weeks to come. We remember before God those who have died, and ask that those bereaved by always aware of the light of Christ, which eternally shines and brings so much hope. So today we remember the family and friends of Falotti. And we also bring before you this morning anyone whose anniversaries occur at this time. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we ask you to lead us into the coming week. Help us to believe that you are close by us. Keep us from making mistakes, and help us to never disappoint you. When we face hard decisions or difficult work, when we enjoy ourselves and have fun with others, may we know that you share these times with us. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen.
You please stand as we now share the kiss. God is love. And those who live in love live in God, and God lives in them. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
So, unfortunately, we can't, of course, shake hands. We haven't done it for a few months now, it'll be a year and a half. But we can turn to each other and just exchange a sign of peace, a sign of greeting.
Thank you.
We remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence, his sacrifice made once and for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and the cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ is alive. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people, gather us in your loving arms, and bring us with all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, forever and ever. As our Saviour taught us, so together we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are not one body, because we will share. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord. So we come to the final part of our service, our closing prayers. First, an additional prayer for this Sunday. Loving Father, we thank you for feeding us at the supper of your Son. Sustain us with your Spirit, that we may serve you here on earth until our joy is complete in heaven and we share the eternal banquet with Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And our final prayer together. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out to the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen.
Before Stuart gives the blessing, Daniel wants to speak and tell you about what's been happening to the organ this week.
Morning. So we've had a few issues with the organ over the last couple of months, and we've had the organ builder in, and we've not spent a lot of money on the organ for many years. Now, we've got a wonderful member of the congregation who covers the tunings that we've had, which are just short of £300. But I don't know whether some of you have heard at the end of services, sometimes the organ dips and the blowers have got a big crack in them. And if we don't repair that kind of soonish, it could just pack up and it just have no power to it because there's not enough wind to get into the organ. So that one is going to cost £595. And then we've also got some other parts of the organ that have started to collapse over time. So altogether we're looking for about £3,000. I am going to try and look for grants, and we're going to work with the PCCs to see what we can do to access further funding. But I know some people have asked over the last couple of years and said if there's anything that's needed in the organ, some people may want to donate. Now, I'm not saying anybody has to donate, but it'd be great if as a church we could try and maybe help, because the organ is a, for me, I'm biased. The organ is a wonderful part of our worship, and we just don't want to lose that. So, thank you.
Any other notices?
No.
No? Okay. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. And so now go in peace to love and to serve the Lord.